Hello, everyone. Will everyone please rise for the invocation by Mary Grace Williams?
With us this afternoon, as we gather virtually to honor the graduates of the class of 2020. While we experience this momentous occasion, being separated and distanced due to the pandemic, we are still united by the achievements and accomplishments of these students who face tremendous challenges and obstacles to meet their goals as graduates of Bard College. They are an inspiration to us all, and we give thanks for their presence and their gifts in this beloved community here at Bard. To their families and friends who have shepherded them throughout their time at Bard, giving them encouragement, support, compassion, and care, we ask you, God, to continue to be with them as they now help to usher these graduates into the world beyond Bard. And to the staff, faculty, trustees, and our president, who have given their devotion, time, wisdom, and guidance to help our students achieve so much in such a turbulent time. Continue to bless them, O Lord, as they might continue to do the work you have given them to do. And finally, grant these students your light and truth, and help them to meet the future with hope and the assurance of your loving presence. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated, everyone. And here we go. I will be short or brief, I hope, I think. My name is Jim. I'm the chair of the Board of Trustees, but I'm not going to be normal today. Let me say, to begin, with deep respect and reverence, Black Lives Matter. I will steal words from Michelle Obama. Enough is enough. Sure the duck is. I want to tell you all why I'm not there. I needed to respect the regulations of the great state of New York. It is because of science. I respect science. Scio, scire, the root in Latin of our word science, means to know. I am in quarantine just around the corner because I come from a stupid state. I just arrived Sunday from the great stupid state of Georgia, from the magnificently epic, modern, old, hip, diverse, and in many ways, one of the cradles of the civil rights movement, city of the ATL, Atlanta. I want to be with y'all, and I am here on the Marconi wires. I want to be back on that stage. I wanted to meet and fan man over Mr. Byrne, Mr. David Byrne, Mr. Talking Heads, and Miss Brilliant Laurie Anderson, to whom I rocked hard whilst in my halcyon days at Bard, undergraduate years, at CBGB's, the Mud Club, Danceteria, Agora Ballroom, and the Fox Theater in Atlanta, and other world culturally, poetically giant venues for you freaks that changed the world musically and artistically. I wanted to meet you, and so I am today. Hello, Mr. Byrne, and thank you for accepting this invitation to receive our degree. It is a great pleasure for me, but more importantly, a greater honor for us at Bard. Welcome, and please come back often. Thank you for your art, and thank you, all of the distinguished guests, for participating. All of you, Secretary Chu, and all of the people that I look forward on the other side of the eight ball, when we can meet at Leon's house for lunch or dinner. I'm a farmer. I've been away in the ATL for 8 months, handling pandemic family responsibilities like all of us. I returned Sunday and have jumped the ground with the tractor for 3 evenings in a row. Mother Earth is the great seductress and dominatrix, working good soil with the hopes of growing crops, fruits, berries, hay, apples. I love me some apples, is the farmer's heaven on earth. That is what we want for all of you, heaven on this earth. Not some illusion awaiting us in the afterlife, but again, quoting Michelle, enough is enough. We have all lost greatness and loved ones in one way or another this year of COVID-19 myopic genocide. I lost my last doggy of 27 years worth of one dog family. And I lost my two heroes, my mom and my congressman. My mom, my greatest teacher ever, passed onwards in January at the sanctified age of 100 years old. My congressman, your congressman, our congressman, our commencement speaker of 3 years ago, the giant of a human, John Lewis, may they rest in their peace. But I know from knowing and loving, learning from both of them, they would say, don't look down, which is hard for a moody suck like me. Look up, pick yourself up, put your feet firmly in the ground of Mother Earth and give it. Give this run of this lifetime all you got and fight like hell and don't back down. When it comes to police, I say whatever you want to say is okay. Defund, refund, fund, systematically analyze the funds of the police. I say retrain the police, top to bottom, everywhere, to be 100% civil servants of the highest order, not executioners or not civil torturers. The night John Lewis died, which was the same day that the great C.T. Vivian died in the ATL, I did not know what to do. I was heartbroken. I got in the car and drove down to the Wendy's where Rashard Brooks was killed a few weeks earlier. The activity of those earlier weeks was gone. It was an empty, dark, fast food drive-in surrounded by chain link fence. And I said to myself, a man got killed here because he was asleep in his car. And then I thought, no, he didn't. He got killed because of the color of his blessed skin, God's skin, our skin. If a cop had found me asleep at my wheel in the ATL, I guarantee you, I would have been politely put in an Uber and sent home. Good night, Mr. Chambers. Enough is enough. George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, Rashard Brooks, Elijah McClain, Philando Castile, Tamir Rice, Sandra Bland, Michael Brown, Eric Garner, Trayvon Martin, Freddie Gray, Walter Scott, James Byrd. Say their names. Enough is enough. For all of you inclined to vote, vote. For all of you disinclined to vote, vote. For all of you who think you will never want to vote because they are all chumps and sellouts, vote. Take other people to vote. Fight this twisted system and renew this earth. We do not have to poison ourselves with climate change. Within this past week, we have had the hottest temperature on record since 1931, 130 degrees in Death Valley, and potentially two hurricanes for the first time simultaneously in the Gulf of Mexico. Don't look at me and say there ain't no climate change. There is. Don't look at me and marginalize the scientists and the artists. I ain't gonna take it. Enough is enough. Institutional genocide has existed within us for four centuries. Now, within the last 4 years, we have ripped the curtain of the Band-Aid off, and we are drenched in the blood of our country women and country men, blatantly, criminally, arrogantly. To see the pendulum from the 1960s swing back like this is a straight up nightmare to a Southern man like me. We do not have to allow ourselves to let our education system be strangled, to allow flat earth Karens to take up the airwaves. We must not allow narcissistic war criminals to hold us up as a nation with 177,000 and counting deaths from what I call intentional genocide of people of color. We do not have to stand for slave era drug laws. Release all prisoners today for marijuana violations. Smoke some herb, Washington. Let us revere John Lewis and fight. I lost my heroes, but as I look in the eyes of my children and grandchildren, I see my heroes. When I tromp into the room at 3 a.m. and kiss my little one, he coos like a dove, and I see my hero. In this class of 2020, in this most extraordinarily different year that any of us have ever had, in this class of 2020, Bard College Raptors, I see my heroes. Take this degree as a stepping stone to greatness, to change, to fight. We await your deeds and actions to help make all of us right together. Thank you to all the staff, faculty, and most dearly, your families. I have cried many times this week. Now, with love and peace, I'm ready to crack some skulls and break some bones. Thank you for allowing me to not be normal. Alhamdulillah. I could go on and on, but I'm done. Thank you. Love you, Mama. Love you, John. Love you, Bard. Thank you. And now I give you our great president, Leon Botstein.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you all to this commencement ceremonies. For those watching in New York State, we are permitted to take our masks off when we speak and put them back on. And so I'm taking the liberty within the regulations of doing so. We're very vigilant about health, which is why our chair, Jim Chambers, just spoke to you from the campus. He's in a quarantined location here on campus, and I'm very grateful to him for participating. And as you heard from his speech, I could not be more proud of his membership and leadership and more grateful. And his speech, its eloquence, and its content are tributes, in my view, to the education he got here. He and I both arrived at Bard at the same time. I met him on the first or second day I was here as president, and he came as a first-year student. So I want to thank Jim once again on behalf of all of us and the entire board. So ladies and gentlemen, you're in for a somewhat long afternoon. It's a little different from the usual afternoons we have on these events. For those of you who've never been here, there's a procession, and there are lots of families and friends and errant strangers running around. There's a lot of joy and pride in the graduating class. And this is, of course, different. And so I first want to thank all the members of the Buildings and Grounds staff, of the Environmental Services staff, all the technical people, all the faculty who've come out and helped us, and all the administrative staff that have made this afternoon possible. This was much harder to put together than a regular commencement, and I'm very proud of the collaboration that we have created here. This is a poor institution, and there's a virtue in poverty, similar to the virtues that many monastic orders have. Wealth is not the straightest line between mediocrity and excellence. And we live by our wits, and the faculty and staff have been determined to keep BART going through the pandemic. We did brilliantly online in the spring. We have our first year students here now, and returning students are coming back. We believe in the community of learning and in the public space, despite the hardships. Social distancing is not about learning. Having a mask that prevents us from seeing each other smile is not about learning, certainly not about the making of the arts, but we have to proceed. And this college is proud to move forward in a safe and responsible way to provide the education it has to offer to the students here in Annandale, to the students all over the BART network in the inner cities and in the prisons of New York State. I want to particularly thank the honorary degree recipients who've made the travel here. And there is a wonderful audience out there, and I want to thank everyone who is watching on this and will watch later as this is able to be revisited. These are long events, but those of us who are veterans of varying religious ceremonies know it's going to be shorter than most religious ceremonies. It's a ritual which these gowns represent, and these two chairs here, which we've brought back from the chapel, which are the bishop's chair where Mary Grace is seated, and the warden's chair, which was the name the presidents of this college had in the 19th century, to give everyone watching a sense of the history. I want to congratulate all the families and all the friends of the graduates. Every graduate of class of 2020, which is a remarkable class, will be able to come to a commencement in 2021, in 2022, and 2023 with family and friends and participate in the joyous ceremonies that would have otherwise taken place. And last but not least, I do want to thank the members of the brass quintet, which come from our graduate program, who performed brilliantly in their socially distanced outdoor bucolic setting. So, welcome to a wonderful and celebratory afternoon. Now, the nice thing about graduating from college is that, unlike marriage, it happens only once. We can get married many times, but getting more than one BA is requires a visit to a psychiatrist. And most people do it only once, so we take our time in providing that degree. And you'll see it'll be faster than we usually do when young people come across the stage as we deliver the degrees in this ceremony. It is now my pleasure to introduce our commencement speaker, whom Jim so eloquently described. David Byrne is Scottish born, but had most of his education here in the United States. He went to RISD, where he founded the Talking Heads. He is an unbelievably gifted and versatile artist. He's worked in every possible medium, part of a group, as a solo performer in music, in films, in theater, experimental theater, and his American Utopia. And he has both lectured and spoken and written. He's a protean artist of unbelievable energy and talent, and was, as Jim suggests, a figure for many generations of listeners, and he represents the highest ideals that we have in the arts. And so without further ado, please join me in welcoming David Byrne as our commencement speaker. Cool.
Thank you. Congratulations to the brass ensemble. It's very difficult to play together when you're distanced. I heard a story from a musician the other day. There was socially distanced orchestra that was playing, and some of the musicians said, "You have to gesture bigger. We can't see you." So the conductor had to make it bigger than before so that everybody could see. What do I have? This is certainly my first time talking to a live audience and to a live audience in many, many months. It's kind of strange. It's kind of wonderful. It's strange and wonderful to be gathered in a group of people this much. I'm encouraged by this institution. I was invited to come here. I have some familiarity with this place. I understand what BARD stands for. I recently worked with a BARD alumni named Alex Coleman on a book. I've written about the BARD Prison Initiative, which I think some of you will be familiar with. And I've read some pieces that Mr. Botstein wrote about music. This place is special. I've been here, visited here a few times over the years. I saw an exhibition at the gallery in 2008. The gallery had been turned into a recreation of the artist Keith Edmire's parents' house with all its extreme 70s decor. It was like walking into a movie set. And you know, as you walk into a movie set, you know that it's all fake, but part of you is still seduced to feeling that you're in that place. There's this kind of wonderful tension in something like that where you know it's fake, but you kind of feel like you're in the place at the same time, between the real and the artificial. And we are in a world that someone has made that is just like the world that this artist made of his parents' house. His world, like our world, is unreliable. It's based on unreliable memory and imagination. We all do this. We make these artificial worlds. The difference is we have to live in them. A world that's made like this, it can be a seductive lie or it can be a revealing truth. On a thing like this, a commencement, I imagine it's common to ask oneself, well, what comes next for me? What comes for me as I leave this place? Will I be a different person? Will I be a different person than I was a month ago? Well, I think we're all different than we were last week. Things are changing incredibly rapidly. And then you ask, what person am I now? And how should I be as that person? What do I love? What does that entail? What, if any, are there any obligations? Obligations to myself, obligations to a larger community. How does one reconcile oneself between one's personal rights, one's personal desires, and those of the community and the collective? What have I learned here? Has the world changed? Has the world changed since the spring? It probably has. Has it changed into something far different than the world that I knew? Is that a good thing? Is everything I learned here at this institution now meaningless? I don't think so. I'm very sorry for the world you inherit, that we've left you a mess, the one that we made, the world that we made. But there are reasons to be cheerful. The pandemic has pulled back the curtain, which has revealed both the worst and the best of what and who we are. Arundhati Roy, the writer, referred to this moment as a portal, when we have unprecedented opportunity to change things, to cross into another world. In this moment, we have been both cursed and blessed. This is one of those moments that occur once in a while. Ideas that were taken as given, economic ideas, cultural ideas, etc., are being questioned, reconsidered. An era based on a set of biases and assumptions is ending. In a sense, we're lucky. The portal that she mentions is open, and we have a chance to go through it. I'm as guilty as anyone else of waking up in the morning and feeling that nothing really changes very much. I have moments of despair and anger and frustration, no surprise. Martin Luther King Jr.'s quote, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice." Some mornings that feels like an empty platitude when I read it and when I look at the news that morning. It sometimes feels like, oh, you know, same as it ever was. But that's not really true. The real constant is change. We often forget or overlook the momentous changes in our thinking that we now accept as obvious, inevitable. But in truth, nothing was inevitable. The changes that happened, that we live with now, for better or worse, they're here because we made them so. Okay, here's a few of them. Slavery is now universally considered unacceptable. 2,000 years ago, Aristotle thought slavery was natural and necessary. But even then, his contemporaries argued that it was unacceptable. These changes don't happen overnight. Okay, here's another one. Women should be allowed to vote. If I said to anyone now, or if you heard someone else say, no, women should not be allowed to vote, you would think that was completely ridiculous. It happened in the United States. It took state by state. 100 years ago. In Saudi Arabia, it happened 5 years ago. But it happened. Education, primary and secondary education so far, I think everyone accepts that it should be free. It's a right for everyone to have it. This was not always true. Children were considered cheap labor. Eventually, maybe higher education will be considered a right as well. Interracial marriage. I think we all accept this now. We all accept this. This seems like, what's the big deal? The Supreme Court made a ruling legalizing interracial marriage in 1967, not that long ago. Alabama had some laws on the books that counteracted the Supreme Court ruling, and those were overturned 20 years ago. Okay, gay marriage, okay, we all know that this is now law, this is now legal. When I was a young person, if someone had told me that this would be legal and generally accepted, I would have said, you're crazy. This should happen, but it's going to take forever. But just 5 years ago, in 2015, it was recognized as legal in all 50 states. I can go on. I have infrastructure, clean air, clean water. There's things that don't exist for us entirely now, but we do think of them as our right. And these ideas that we consider as part of our lives and how it is to live and how it is to be, it didn't always have to be that way. It wasn't always that way. This is something new in the world, and the world has changed. These changes weren't predictable. And they weren't inevitable. I'm a little older than some of you, and I can say that some of these changes, they weren't expected. They weren't expected to happen as soon as they did. And when they did, then they seemed inevitable. People make these changes. Things that seemed impossible have happened, and they will continue to happen. Try and imagine what radical, momentous changes in our thinking might happen next. And they will. We can imagine what they might be. Okay, Make no mistake, things can go wrong. Things can go the other way. This country was ever so slowly inching towards democracy. But as in many other countries around the world, there's been some serious backsliding. There's no guarantee the change will be good. That part is up to us. And so I ask myself, how do these changes happen? Where's the levers? Where's the buttons? What's the process? What can we, as a lone individual, or with a little group of people, what can we do to have an effect? I suppose you might ask yourself the same question. Does my line of work have any wider resonance? Not that every line of work has to focus directly or solely on social justice. I believe that the meaning of what we do in our work and our lives is more subtle than that. I'll use myself as an example. Okay. Most of the time, I'm a performer and a musician. And it seems to me that music and performance affects people's view of the world, not directly, not by me writing a song about climate policy or housing inequities, although I might like to do that. Rather, it works in a less didactic and non-kind of text-based ways. It's kind of a language without words. Music creates community. When I was young, I heard music on a little radio that was about the size of a phone. And I realized when I heard this music that there was a world out there that was very different and wider than the little suburban town that I lived in. We've heard people say things like, that song saved my life, or that DJ saved my life. And these are kind of cliches, but there's a truth to it. Music can have that kind of effect. It reveals a larger world, and it brings people together because they know that there are other people out there like them. For someone else, it might not be music that has this effect. It might be the visual arts, theater, cooking, dance. It might be ways of thinking and education, sustainability, even economics. It can touch people who hear about a new idea and it changes their thinking. I also think that one discipline needs to influence all the others. There needs to be a lot of curiosity about what's going on in other disciplines, and one discipline can, in surprising ways, affect another one. When I heard the music of James Brown as a young man, I came to realize that here is music where no one part is more important than any other. The melody is not played by one instrument, but it emerges out of the interlocking parts played by all the instruments. The groove is not just played by the drums, but it comes into being as a result of what everyone is doing. I sense that unlike traditional Western music, Brown's music is non-hierarchical. In his musical model, we're given an audio metaphor. We hear, metaphorically, a model of social organization and cooperation that makes us feel joyous and transported. We're not kind of intellectually going through all this, but I feel like we sense it. Here, I sense there's a social and economic argument made with music. And the transcendent feeling it brings when you hear and experience it is more persuasive than language. Music proposes a world. Metaphorically, it gives evidence of that possibility. An economist hearing James Brown might possibly see the world in a different way. Of course, my model for cross-disciplinary influence comes from music, but it can go the other way as well. I'm going to mention the first abstract artist, Hilma af Klint, who was influenced by spiritualism that was prevalent about over 100 years ago, turn of the last century. It had been proposed that one of the reasons for the wide enthusiasm for the spiritualism was because of the scientific discoveries that were happening at that time. The science was showing that there were invisible forces in our world. Electromagnetism, radiation, radio waves, X-rays, the entire world, ourselves included, are affected by these invisible and pervasive forces. Science proposed this world, a world that hadn't previously existed in our imagination. And this affected how these artists worked. They realized that what we see with our eyes is only part of what is there, and artists like Af Klint and others began to attempt, via abstraction, to represent this world, a world of energies that can go through buildings and go through our bodies. So, with art and science, we conjure worlds. And over time, we who conjure these worlds, we ourselves change. And then the worlds that we conjure, those change as well. A couple of years ago, after I was finished a music tour that lasted almost a year, I decided to go to India. I went to catch a traditional music festival in Chennai. It was wonderful. It was wonderful. I saw a kid in a young kid in a kind of Elvis outfit playing Carnatic music on a saxophone. I saw singers communicating with drummers with their hands. And I also went to Kerala, which is another state in the south. And there's a kind of performance there called Kudiyattam. It's an ancient form of dance drama. It's about 1,000 years old. In this dance drama, the performer begins the performance by metaphorically dancing into existence and kind of proposing a world. This will be the world that the story will take place in, kind of like Star Wars or Game of Thrones. It's complete. It has a cosmology. It has a history, every detail. In the dance drama, the world building is not made with sets and props and computers. It's conjured in the audience's imagination via singing and dancing and gesture. Like the actors in this drama, we, in whichever field we endeavor, we also dance a new world into existence, not just in music or theater. Every kind of work and activity we engage in proposes a world. In the end of the Kudiyattam performance, the actors dismantle the world that they have made. Likewise, we destroy an old world, a worn-out world, the one we ourselves of others before us have made, so that a new one can be imagined and brought into existence. Thank you. Thank you, guys. You want more?
I want to thank you, David Byrne, for coming and speaking. Our honorary degree recipients form the base from which we draw our commencement speakers. And the reason we are here today is to give degrees. And every graduate from the class of 2020 will get this red book. And I don't know how much of it is online. Those of you who are here have the red book. And you can follow the rest of the commencement exercises in the book. As we start with the degrees, we give them to the honorary degree recipients. We're changing the routine a little bit this year because of the effort they've made and because of the special nature and the fact that we don't have the physical giving of degrees. We've invited each of the honorary degree recipients to say a few words if they're so inclined. We would be very grateful, and the listening audience around the world, because 20% of our student body comes from abroad, I think will be very grateful. The honorary degrees are given because they mirror the virtues we try to cultivate in our undergraduates. And the one virtue I left for last in David Byrne's case is that he has a lifelong commitment to bicycle riding, if I'm not mistaken. And he has spent an enormous amount of time doing it. And so for those of you who are enthusiasts of exercise, particularly bicycling, can see that it's consistent with greatness in other fields. I want to also warn you again that this is an exercise that highlights the central medium of the university and college experience, and that is the use of language. So there are speeches, and the use of words and language is at the core of our creation of a community and our ideals about how a society should be governed. So there are speeches, and we welcome them. In the book, you'll see that there are prizes and awards given to undergraduates, particularly the class of 2020. We gave those prizes out yesterday and to the class of 2020, a very distinguished class. We also publish the awards we give at our annual award ceremony. I want to highlight Barbara Grossman, a trustee of the college, who received the highest medal that can be given for service to the college, the Bard Medal. To Juliet Morrison from the class of 2003, the Bard Award in Medicine and Science. To Xavier F. Simmons from the class of 2005, the Charles Flynn Kellogg Award in the Arts. And two John Dewey Awards to Nicholas Asensio and Matthew Taibbi from the class of 1992. The award in honor of Mary McCarthy, one of our distinguished writer colleagues who lived on this campus, was given to Carolyn Forche. And then we have four retiring staff and faculty members to whom we gave Bardian Awards. Peggy Owish, a longtime backbone, if you will, of the film program. Matthew Deedy, a fabulous teacher of physics and mathematics. Bonnie Marcus, an alumna who is associate director of admissions. And one of our great colleagues in music, Richard Teitelbaum, the pioneer in electronic music, who passed away this year. We also gave in the prisons an award to Emily Toe at Taconic Correctional Facility for her philanthropic and leadership support and leadership for the Bard Prison Initiative. So we now turn to the first of the honorary degrees, and I would like to recognize Barbara Grossman, the class of 73, and Dominique Townsend, the Assistant Professor of Buddhist Studies, who will present Laurie Anderson for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the great honor of presenting Laurie Anderson as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Fine Arts.
Laurie Anderson is a performer and musician working predominantly with sound, music, speech, and song. Over the 50 years of her legendary career to date, she has experimented widely as a multimedia and visual artist, composer, poet, photographer, and filmmaker. Her work with virtual reality and artificial intelligence exemplify the capacity of artists to contribute to technological innovation. Across these media, Anderson is a consummate collaborator, deeply appreciative of and responsive to other artists. Her cooperative works reflect an ethos of mutual admiration and generosity. An art history graduate of Barnard College with an MFA from Columbia University, Anderson is motivated to tell stories. She writes in All the Things I Lost in the Flood, great title, Americans have traditionally demanded coherent and simple national stories. Now, many of these stories no longer make any sense. We are in story limbo. And for a storyteller, this is an intensely interesting place to be. As a storyteller in a time of limbo, she deals with identity, memory, happiness, death, place, and love, always relevant, especially today. While rejecting polemics, Anderson is unflinching in her criticism of unjust structures of power. For two decades, she has developed projects related to imprisonment. Alertness to the potential for exploitation undergirds these works. She wrote about habeas corpus, her 2015 collaboration with Mohamed El-Ghani, a former Guantanamo detainee, in The New Yorker, explaining that it started as, quote, a meditation about real time and telepresence, how to be there and not there at the same time. But her vision changed as her collaborator shaped the piece with stories of his own about the years he spent imprisoned and tortured. All of Anderson's artwork is suffused with the acknowledgement that the world is indeed full of distress and injustice, but this is balanced with her flat-out refusal to give in to despair. It's as if she's determined to bear witness and feel pain without ceding pleasure and delight. She accomplishes this balance in part through play, for instance, playing with the ambiguity of language. This, along with vibrant curiosity, fuels her seemingly dauntless energy to create innovative art. I first encountered her work in 1996, wandering galleries in New York City. Anderson, a violinist, had produced a table as silent and still as any table, until you put your elbows down and covered your ears, at which point your bones become conduits for vocals and instrumentals flowing from the inside. The sheer delight of handphone table characterizes much of Anderson's work, even as she looks squarely into the face of despondency and loss. Anderson is a practitioner of meditation, as was her husband, musician Lou Reed, who died in 2013. She quotes their Tibetan teacher, Yange Mingor Rinpoche, saying, "You need to try to master the ability to feel sad without actually being sad." During our current global crisis, which reveals so incisively how interconnected memory, place, love, and death are in our seemingly isolated lives, Laurie Anderson shows us how to feel deeply and connectedly without being overcome.
I'm going to say something in Latin before you speak. So those of you who are not familiar with our ceremony, we are an Anglo-Catholic institution by origin, and our degrees are in Latin. And I'm required to provide you this secular granting, Auctoritate mihi commissa te ad gradum in artibus elegantoribus doctoris admito omni aque jura ac privilegia atum gradum pertidebia tibi concedo et in testimonium hoc diploma tibi solemniter trado. Congratulations to you.
Thank you very, very much. I would just like to say a couple of very brief words to the graduates today, and just to say what an amazing moment this must feel like to you at the beginning of the year, and then moving towards this moment where everything stopped. And I just want to talk about how that, what that might mean. We look on the one hand, at cities that are completely deserted. And you could look at it in one way and think, neutron bomb, what happened? This is a disaster. And in another way, of course, it's one of the greatest acts of empathy on a planetary scale, of people staying inside to help each other. And so many people are actually doing that. So as you look around and ask yourself, what does this mean? There are so many different answers that you can come up with. I have a friend who has a five-year-old kid, and he was, people started talking about the coronavirus, and he didn't know the word virus. So what he heard was corona pirates. And so he thought, the whole world is fighting the corona pirates, some pirates from Corona, and we're all putting on masks and, you know, going to battle. So seeing this kind of a war, and of course for you it might be seeing it as some kind of like strange interruption, and I want to encourage you to think of this as one of the greatest opportunities that will ever come your way, to get a chance to stop. You don't have to just move right out into corporate America or the corporate art world as well, you know, which has become very machine-like. We knew things weren't going so well. Every generation, there's something like this that happens, and this is your moment to look at what this is. There are some downsides, of course. Some of you have to go and live with your parents, and for some, that's great, and for others, it's a unique kind of hell. You know, you have to go backwards instead of flying out. You're pushed back. But I want to just say a couple of things that I want you to keep in mind. Is it's really two things. Please don't get dragged into the stories of the media. The stories that the media is selling right now is that there's a civil war in this country, and that people are fighting each other, and there's so much disagreement. Yes, there are some bad people here. There are a few neo-Nazis here and there, some really bad people. But for the most part, this is not a civil war. This is a country in which people are behaving so well right now, trying their best to do things. We have to remember that news doesn't work like that. News wants you to go, what do you think about that? What's the problem with that? So, don't get dragged into that story. Second is vote. As everyone has said, no matter what, just vote. The third thing I want to say is, and the last thing, is that I spent a lot of time with my husband trying to come up for reasons to live. You know, in times like this, you think, like, what is this for? What if I just had a couple of things I could hold on to, maybe it would be easier. And we spent a long time discussing what those would be. And I'm just going to tell you this before I thank you very much for this great honor, is those three things. And number one is don't be afraid of anyone. And you think of how your life might be different if you were afraid of no one. Number two, get a really good bullshit detector and learn how to use it. Learn how to use it is very important. And three, be really, really tender. Good luck to all of you graduates. Congratulations, and thank you for this great honor.
I now recognize Roland Augustine, member of the Board of Trustees of the College, and Kyle Gann, the Taylor Hover and Frances Bartle Hover Professor of Music, who will present David Byrne for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting David Byrne as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Fine Arts.
Last year, in the New York Times, Ben Brantley made a case for David Byrne being the Mr. Rogers of music. The difference between them being, he wrote, that Byrne just happens to infuse his teaching with a beat that turns everyone into a spasmodic Sant Vitus dancer. Byrne is indeed a calm, conversational visionary whose creativity spreads outward from his music into video, film, theater, performance art, books, and photography. His art typically achieves universality by focusing on the quotidian: food, houses, shopping malls, TV. His deadpan sense of humor celebrates the absurdity of everyday life without direct appeal to philosophy. He's worn oversized suits to make his head look small. interviewed himself on film, and danced with a floor lamp. He wrote his oft-cited charming goofiness large and took it mainstream. Born in Scotland, but growing up in Baltimore, Byrne attended the Rhode Island School of Design and Maryland Institute College of Art. He came to prominence in 1975 with the band Talking Heads, a group so original that the term New Wave was coined to classify it. From its minimalist beginnings, the band quickly branched out into art rock, hip-hop, afro-pop, and the avant-garde. Having grabbed attention with iconic rock albums like More Songs About Buildings and Food and Fear of Music, he infused Nigerian dance rhythms into Remain in Light, Speaking in Tongues, added tropes from gospel worship to the mix. Since then, no one style or medium has been able to contain or define his protean development. He wrote the score for choreographer Twyla Tharp's dance, The Catherine Wheel, and lyrics for Philip Glass. The Talking Heads' 1984 film, Stop Making Sense, directed by Jonathan Demme, has been hailed as the best concert film ever made. His directorial debut, True Stories, takes an affectionate yet absurdist look at small town life in the Texas panhandle. Recently, David's career has seemed to expand without boundaries. In 2008, he turned a ferry terminal in Manhattan, the Battery Marine Maritime Building, into a musical instrument by electronically connecting its parts to a pipe organ that audience members could play to, quote, make art themselves, not just look at it. An inveterate bicycle rider for more than 40 years, he wrote a book called Bicycle Diaries, recalling his experiences riding through cities around the world and musing on how their structures and history reflect human character. His book, How Music Works, turns ideas of creativity upside down, explaining how art is not merely an inner impulse, but a response to both environment and opportunity. Last year, he brought a stage show, American Utopia, to Broadway, to rave reviews. These activities across the spectrum have been marked by Byrne's idiosyncratic sensibility, a geeky sense of wonder at the mysteries of everyday life. He's a singer who once said, the better the singer's voice, the harder it is to believe what they're saying. That self-effacing and self-aware attitude has made David Byrne an amusing and empowering force for creativity for more than four decades.
I'm now going to say the Latin, Catoritate mi commissa te gradum in artibus et elegantum voribus tec doctoris admito omniaque jura ad privilegia ad gradum pertinetia tibi concedo et in testimonium hoc diploma tibi solemniter prado. Congratulations. Now recognize James von Klemper, parent and trustee of Bard College, and Emily McLaughlin, professor of chemistry and associate dean of the college, who will present Stephen Chu for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting Stephen Chu as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Science.
Stephen Chu, Doctor of Science. Stephen Chu, William R. Kennan, Jr. Professor of Physics at Stanford University and Professor of Molecular and Cellular Physiology at Stanford School of Medicine, has described himself as the academic black sheep of his family. In his youth, Chu viewed schoolwork as a chore, but spent his extracurricular time satisfying an insatiable curiosity, building erector sets, experimenting with chemistry kits, and even creating a neighborhood soil testing business. Chu completed his undergraduate studies in physics and mathematics at University of Rochester and his doctorate at the University of California, Berkeley. He has earned patents in atomic and polymer physics, biophysics, and energy technologies, and received numerous accolades, including the 1997 Nobel Prize in Physics. One could hardly call him an academic outsider. He credits his high school physics teacher for introducing him to a way of studying both simple and complex by using a set of assumptions and observations in the creation of a theory which could be verified or refuted by experimentation. Chu's career is a consistent refrain of this practice. In the 1980s, at AT&T Bell Laboratories, Chu and his collaborators developed a technique for laser cooling and atom trapping that was so transformative, it was recognized with the Nobel Prize. Using multiple lasers arranged in specific configuration and frequency, Chu successfully slowed atomic speeds from 4,000 kilometers per second to just centimeters per second, creating a liquid-like grouping of atoms dubbed optical molasses. Paired with two magnetic coils, a trap to detain atoms for further study or manipulation. This work paved the way for a more accurate atomic clock, enabling more advanced global positioning systems, GPS, and quantum computing, among other applications, including optical tweezers. Optical tweezers are able to hold, manipulate, and visualize single molecules, and along with fluorescent resonance energy transfer, FRET, allowed Chu to study the dynamics of enzyme, protein, and RNA activity, setting a precedent for biological research. At Stanford, he helped launch the pioneering BioX Interdisciplinary Biosciences Institute. Chu has led the United States movement towards sustainable energy. He served as the director of Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory from 2004 until 2008. There, he spearheaded the Helios project, prioritizing research on renewable energy sources. In 2009, he was appointed the 12th United States Secretary of Energy by President Barack Obama. He was the first scientist and the first Nobel laureate to be appointed to the US cabinet and remains the longest serving energy secretary. Chu assisted BP in redressing the Deepwater Horizon oil leak and initiated important programs, including the ARPAE, Advanced Research Projects Agency Energy, and Energy Innovation Hubs, coordinating efforts across government, industry, and academia to solve energy challenges. In 2019, Chu became president and now serves as the chair of the board of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, which strives to promote science, engineering, and innovation throughout the world for the benefit of all people. We honor Stephen Chu for his exceptional accomplishments in physics, his staunch advocacy for the renewable energy research, and above all, his unbarred curiosity in pursuit of scientific advancements.
Laureatato in commissa Terra Dragon incientis doctoris admito omniaque iure ad privilegia ad hom gradum pertinentia tibi concigo et in testimonium hoc diploma tibi solemne trato. Congratulations.
So I think I should begin. I hope you can all hear me. And if not, someone can flash a sign to my monitor. It's an honor to be part of this event. And in my brief remarks, I'm gonna talk about what has been happening in this very strange time where, in the use of physics language, we seem to enter into an alternate universe. But the reality is, we're in the midst of a devastating pandemic. We live in a country which is obvious to all those who want to look. We have continued racial and social injustice and of course, climate change. So to the graduates today, you can ask yourselves, what can you do during these troubled times? The news is so depressing that it might be tempting for you to just tune out and retreat to your own private lives, your own bubbles. But I ask you, don't give up. You're giving up if you tune out. You have a great education, and the most important part of that education is learning how to teach yourself and to think critically. So stay informed and engaged, and do what you can to make the world a better place. It's easy to blame others, and certainly my generation deserves the blame, but we should also look at ourselves in the mirror. We will get a vaccine, but in the meantime, it's the moral obligation of everybody to wear masks and socially distance as much as possible, not only to protect yourselves, but your family, your parents, your grandparents, and the older members of society. Many of us have had friends who have died of COVID-19. Last night, around midnight, the husband of a collaborator that I'm working with on face mask protection died of this disease. He was in his 40s. We still have a long way to go to realize Martin Luther King and John Lewis's dream. But the good news is the conscience of our country is waking up. Climate change remains the 8,000-pound gorilla in the room. Climate change may be the greatest social injustice of all because it's the poorest and the most innocent, including those yet to be born, which will be the most effective. Over the past 20 years, I've altered my life to mitigate the worst risks of climate change in administrative and advisory roles and in my own research. But when I look in the mirror, I see I could do much more in lowering my own carbon footprint. In how I live, I do bicycle to work, but unfortunately, I still drive 6,000 miles a year. But how I live in the consumer choices I make, and most important, by consuming and traveling less. So in closing, my warmest congratulations to you, the class of 2020. Vote this November. Get your friends to vote. If you don't vote, you are giving up. Thank you.
I now recognize Brandon Wember, class of 1997, and a member of the Board of Trustees, and Frank Corliss, the director of the Bard College Conservatory of Music, who will present Goa Xiaosong as a candidate for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting Gao Xiaosong as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Fine Arts.
Multi-talented Gao Xiaosong is a composer, singer, music producer, author, film director, talk show host, public intellectual, and one of the most extravagantly gifted men that Tan Dun, who is the dean of the Bard Conservatory of Music, has known. He's a writer of intelligence and insight whose books land frequently on Chinese bestseller lists. He's a man of wit, erudition, and charm, whose talk shows have received more than 900 million views and are legendary within China for his extemporaneous musings on topics ranging from history and culture to current events, arts, and music. A leader in media and the arts, he headed up Alibaba Group's music division and is currently chairman of the Alibaba Entertainment Strategic Committee, focused on international expansion of the group's entertainment sector. Gao Xiaosong was born into an intellectual and artistic family. His father, a photographer, and mother, an architect, were on the faculty of Tsinghua University. Gao himself started studying electrical engineering there, but soon dropped out to study directing at the Beijing Film Academy. He gained fame as a musician with his debut album of 1993 entitled Campus Folk Songs, which won almost all the music awards in China that year. The music is relatable and makes the listeners think about their own lives, Gao has said. He went on to launch multiple musical labels. He notes that China has no record companies when he began his songwriting career, and to write hit songs, produce albums, and embark on concert tours that broke box office records in all of China's major cities. His work in film is equally impressive, beginning in 1999 with his direction of Where Have All the Flowers Gone, which won awards at the Paris and Venice Film Festivals. His films since then, My Old Classmate, My Kingdom, Fragile, This Side Up, Keep Dry, and Rainbow, have been hits throughout Asia. In 2015, Gao founded and became curator of the nonprofit Zha Shuguan Library, which boasts one of the world's largest collections of books and periodicals from the late Qing Dynasty to the Republic of China before 1949. Gao Zhizhong's broad experience in the arts and insight into modern society make him a perspective and visionary cultural leader in China today. But he has become more than that. He's a true bridge builder between the United States and China because of his work extends beyond borders. Tao Dun visually recalls the dinner their families had shared after a North American premiere of Tan's Buddha Passion, his own attempt at connecting Western and Chinese traditions. And as he was listening to Gao, he realized that how he's working to build those bridges between China and the rest of the world. But mostly, he understood how Gao Zhizhong's fast and still growing body of work, his accomplishments as a writer, filmmaker, musician, and educator, creates a heroic and stirring vision for the connected future of all the world's cultures. Gao is an inspiration, and Tan is honored to call him his friend.
Mihi commissa, ter gradum in artibus elegantoribus doctoris admito, omni aquae aiura ac privilegia ad gradum pertinentia tibi concedo et in testimonium hoc diploma tibi solemniter trado. Congratulations.
Thank you. Heartfelt thanks. Today shall be one of the major highlights of my life. It is with profound appreciation and with deep humility that I accept this honorary doctoral degree of fine arts from Bard College. To be bestowed upon this distinguished title from such a venerable institution is a remarkable acknowledgement of my decades-long work, of which I can't be more flattered and more grateful. Thank you again to all of you. Thank you.
I now recognize Roland Augustine back to the podium and Ben Coonley, Associate Professor of Film and Electronic Arts, who will present Thelma Golden for the honorary degree.
In a 2009 talk, Thelma Golden described her curatorial practice. Quote, "My interest is in artists who understand and rewrite history, who think about themselves within the narrative of the larger world of art, and who have created new places for us to see and understand." In her 30-year career as a curator at the Whitney Museum of American Art, and since 2005 as director and chief curator of the Studio Museum of Harlem, where she began in 1987, she has modeled these same values, creating powerful new places for us to see and understand art, specifically work by artists of African descent, and illuminating how political and social issues can be grasped and transformed by culture. A recipient of the 2018 J. Paul Getty Medal, a member of the Barack Obama Foundation's Board of Directors, Golden has made a strong case for art's potential for social change throughout her career and illuminated the catalytic role that artists of African descent have played in culture. Golden distinguished herself as one of the leading curators in the United States while at the Whitney from 1988 to 1998. There, she played a key role in shaping the museum's programming, co-curated the still-debated 1993 Whitney Biennial, which pushed conceptual strategies around identity and representation from the periphery of the art field into its heated center. now seen as a great groundbreaking show that exhibited some of the most significant contemporary artists, such as Andrea Fraser, Glenn Ligon, Lorna Simpson, and Fred Wilson. The Biennial received virulent critical backlash for its bold merger of art and first-person politics. In U.S. World and News Report, critic Hilton Kramer remarked, "There is no cure in sight, short of dismissing the entire staff and entire board of trustees of the museum," close quote. Golden went on to present Black Male, Representations of Masculinity in Contemporary American Art in 1994, an exhibition that upended extant approaches to art history and curatorial method, among many to follow. Her tenure at the Studio Museum has been marked by invention and advocacy through an exhibition program, the renowned artist in residence program, and now through the construction of a new museum, the first home ever built for it. She conceived of the museum's noted series of exhibitions, the F shows, beginning with Freestyle in 2001. Four shows followed, co-organized by Golden or by Studio Museum colleagues, with Golden as chief curator, including works by more than 100 artists of African descent, Frequency in 2005-06, Flow in 2008, Four in 2012 and 13, and Fictions in 2017 and 18. A former member of Bard's Center for Curatorial Studies Graduate Committee and 2016 recipient of the Audrey Ermes Award for Curatorial Excellence, Golden has also characterized her term as director through mentorship, supporting not only successive generations of artists, but also curators and writers. Hers is a trajectory that models curating as a field bigger than objects, about institution building, expanding art history, rewriting incorrect and exclusionary narratives, and opening the door to greater and richer understandings of society through art.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting Thelma Golden as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Humane Letters.
Humani Boribus, Doctoris Admito, Omniaque Jura Ac Privilegia, Ac Cum Gradum Pertitelia Tibi Concedo, et in testimonium hoc diploma Tibi Solemne Vetrado. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. I am so honored and filled with gratitude and so sorry that I cannot be there with you today, but am so thrilled to be here virtually and in this community among the other honorary degree recipients, the faculty, President Botstein, and of course the trustees, students and families, and everyone who's watching. I have had a long relationship with Bard and admire the commitment to equity and education and justice, proud to have served the Center for Curatorial Studies and to have had numerous engagements with students from the Bard Network in my work in Harlem, as well as students from the Bard Prison Initiative. And all of that speaks to what makes this degree so important to me, because it speaks so much to what I believe and what, for me, my life as a curator has been about. I have the privilege of working with and for artists, and it is through that that I get my inspiration. And in a moment like this, so marked by uncertainty, by division, by a reckoning on so many levels, it is through art and from artists from which I am able to begin to imagine a future and work towards it. What I'd love to say to the class of 2020 is that you all, of course, are entering into this uncertain and complex moment. And I know there is so much that probably you question. There are so many ways in which you want to understand what the world holds for you. What I hope that you will see is that what you are getting today is not simply a degree, but an acknowledgement of the tools that have been given to you by your faculty at Bard and your families and by each other in the communities you come from. That is your intellect, your ability to understand the power of your imagination and the great tool that you have in creativity, but also that you enter the world with a sense of gratitude for the privilege that this education represents and use it towards envisioning justice in real ways for all. I often in this moment have kept the words of the great athlete and humanitarian in my mind as I continue to think of the work that we all need to do, right, for this world that needs it so much right now. And those are the words of Arthur Ashe when he said, "Start where you are, use what you have, do what you can." So I want you all to carry that with you. I want you all, of course, to vote, but I also want you all to know that it is your vision and your voice that are going to carry us forward. Thank you.
I now recognize Barbara Grossman, class of 1973, and a member of the Board of Trustees, and Max Kenner, class of 2001, and the Executive Director of the Bard Prison Initiative, who will present Linda E. Johnson for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting Linda E. Johnson as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Humane Letters.
Few institutions are more essential, truly democratic, or genuinely optimistic in today's United States than our public libraries. At a time when expectations of profit or privatization have devastated so many community institutions, public libraries are busier than ever. The resurgence is a rare contemporary phenomena that gives us hope. In this context, Linda Johnson is a remarkable leader of one of the largest and most vital library systems in the country. Raised in Philadelphia, Johnson earned her bachelor's degree at Hamilton College, where she was among the first women graduates. She completed graduate degrees in law and business, and after a career in the private sector, she led the Free Library of Philadelphia Foundation and the National Constitution Center before becoming president and chief executive of the Brooklyn Public Library in 2011. Johnson is a manager whose characteristics, humor in a crisis, willingness to take risks, commitment to providing valuable resources, are well suited to her adopted borough. Brooklyn is one of the most diverse and vibrant places in the country. Just under 40% of its residents were born outside of the United States, and roughly a quarter live below the poverty line. It is poised to take advantage of access to scholarship, the arts, and culture, and make extraordinary contributions to them, as few communities can. Brooklyn Public Library is a vast, dispersed system. 59 branches of various sizes and shapes spread across a borough that on its own would be the fourth largest American city. It is anchored by the Central Library at Grand Army Plaza, a magnificent Art Deco structure at the foot of Prospect Park, and at the intersection of neighborhoods, thoroughfares, and traditions. Walking into Central, patrons encounter an abundance of human energy and democratic spirit, and largely to Johnson's leadership, they also encounter little bureaucracy or security. The library is surely an open and public institution in the best and most meaningful sense. Johnson delivers Brooklyn's wealth of experience back to the residents of Brooklyn. She's opened the library to an annual night of philosophy and ideas, during which thousands of people visit throughout the night to engage in debates and performances. She established an outdoor university open air, taught exclusively by Brooklynites who are immigrants. And she partnered with the Theater of War Productions to deliver free performances of projects addressing public health and social justice, culminating in a 10-week run of Antigone and Ferguson at St. Anne and the Holy Trinity Church. In 2016, Johnson and the Brooklyn Public Library partnered with Bard College to create the first accredited college within a public library and the first Bard microcollege in New York City. It enrolls students whose education has been interrupted or deterred in a full-time, full-scholarship, community-based academic experience. The first students to complete their degrees through the Bard at Brooklyn Public Library graduate today. Too often, leaders in the United States wrongly believe that institutional aspirations to be equitable and inclusive require these organizations to be less ambitious and less daring. We honor Linda Johnson because she knows, and her work proves, the opposite is true.
Actoritate mihi commissio, te ad gradum in litteris, humaniorbius doctoris admito, omni aqua jura ac privilegia, ad un gradum pertinentia tibi concedo, et in testimonium hoc diploma solemniter trago.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
I believe this moment will stay with me for the rest of my days. And not only because I got to hear David Byrne, Laurie Anderson, and Stephen Chu, especially David Byrne, say, you might ask yourself. I want to thank President Botstein, the esteemed deans and faculty of Bard, and in particular, Max Kenner and everybody associated with the Bard Prison Initiative, which I've had the great privilege of working with now for, I guess, over 3 years. And of course, nothing is more important today than the graduates. And in my role at the library, I have the great privilege of being in the center of what we call the microcollege, the Bard at Brooklyn Public Library, liberal arts education. And so I see firsthand the work, the commitment, and the tenacity that it takes to get through the pedagogy and through the lives of students who are not traditional students who find themselves on rural liberal arts campuses, but rather students whose education has been disrupted for one reason or another, but who have demonstrated the ability to think critically, to think critically and to act and to benefit from academic progress in settings other than academic institutions. The library is committed to lifelong learning, and so the charge of the microcollege and the charge of the library are perfectly paired. And it is, of course, extremely humbling to be receiving this honor, not only from an institution like Bard, where creativity is at the center and social justice is at the center of everything that is done, but also to receive the degree at the same time that the first graduates of the Bard Prison Initiative at Brooklyn Public Library are receiving. So thank you, thank you, thank you. And to the graduates, I would say that as a lifelong believer in the benefits of being liberally educated, you have at this moment an extraordinary set of experiences that are behind you and a world certainly with challenges, but also with great hope and possibilities that lays ahead of you. And you have been well prepared for this work. And I would add that as part of the great pleasures of being liberally educated comes a responsibility. And the responsibility is to make sure that everyone has access to the level of education that suits them best. And so if you do nothing else in the rest of your lives, make sure that in some small or however large way you can, that you also help others coming behind you find the same dignity and possibility and joy that comes from being educated. And finally, I would like to thank one person who is probably not on the Zoom call or here with us today, and that is a mentor of mine and an angel who's been sitting on my shoulder for many, many years, former president of Hamilton College, Jean Tobin, who believed in this project and believed in me and in Max and in Leon, and so is in fact sort of at the genesis of bringing this project to New York City, to Brooklyn in particular, and of course, most special to me, to Brooklyn Public Library. Thank you all.
I now recognize David Schwab from the class of 1952, longtime chairman of our board and chairman of the executive committee now, and Deirdre Dalbert, the dean of the college, who will present Ellen Condliff Lagerman as a candidate for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting Ellen Condliff Lagerman as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Humane Letters.
Education research. Through her distinguished administrative leadership at major universities and foundations, she has shaped contemporary understanding of its impact on education policy and on teaching practices. She is a pioneer historian of education, as attested by the broad-based reception of her book, An Elusive Science, The Troubling History of Education Research, and her appointments to prestigious history departments. Her work questions the course that quantitative standardized measures exact on educational opportunity. She offers a powerful modern and educational biography, the genre she practically invented, to account for the lived experiences within and without formal schooling that activate individuals to pursue their potential. Lagerman characterizes her childhood as being populated by civic-minded women of ambition who valued progressive education. Her early research emphasized that sustained gender recognition enables women, even without access to formal institutions, to translate leadership skills from domestic to public spheres. She learned the value of intellectual independence when she designed research for her undergraduate honors thesis at Smith College and encountered the life-changing work of Lawrence Kremen, who would become her dissertation advisor in the history of education at Columbia University. There, studying with electrifying professors, she absorbed the power of great teaching and practiced it herself when she taught high school social studies. But Kremen's mentorship and motto, to write is to act, was what linked her socially progressive family culture to scholarly ambition. As a professor at Columbia University, then at New York University, she wrote deeply researched books on education history that, while readable and candid in style, were also framed by rigorous sociological analysis of organizations, institutions, and professors. Her pioneer writing on philanthropic foundations evinces both respect for their accomplishments and due caution for their dispassionate impact on American public life. Deploying her expertise on private power, she served as president of the Spencer Foundation, where she devised the Usable Knowledge Project to translate education research into practical tools for teachers, students, and policymakers. She developed that project, raising $20 million during her tenure as dean of the Harvard University Graduate School of Education and Charles Warren Professor of the History of American Education. She raised the profile of Ed School, spearheading many ongoing influential public-private initiatives, including the Public Education Leadership Project, which addresses the achievement gap. Ultimately, an issue in hands-on, student-centered learning brought her to Bard College, as Levy Institute Research Professor, as well as a Distinguished Fellow at the Bard Prison Initiative, a program linking progressive education to social justice. Her teaching and advocacy culminated in Liberating Minds, the case for college and prison. Here she boldly claims racism is a root cause of racially skewed prison demographics. Prisons do not make communities safe, and economies and democracies suffer under punitive regimes. The educational biography of Ellen Condleef Lagerman, heir to John Dewey's and Jane Addams' legacies, challenges us to see the students in all people and potential for learning in unlikely places, so that self-liberating minds may achieve their fullest expression.
Actoritate mi commissa, ter gradum in litteris humaniboribus doctoris admito, omniaque jura ac privilegia, ad gradum pertinente bia tibi concedo, et in testimonium hoc diploma tibi solemne trado.
Thank you. It is so nice to take your mask off.
Not all honorary degrees are truly an honor, but one from Bard, indeed any degree from Bard, from an AA to a BA to a master's degree, bestows honor. That's because at Bard, teaching is the college's most important business. Sadly, that is not the case at every college. Even those with unparalleled wealth and prestige, including the one President Botstein chooses to honor by wearing its robe. The primacy Bard places on teaching is evident not only in its theaters, museums, laboratories, and classrooms, but also in its remarkable commitment to civic education and public service. Those of you graduating today have been blessed. You've been offered a remarkable education. But you are also encumbered, and not only with horrible financial debts. Having earned a degree from Bard, you have an obligation to demonstrate in your lives that you embrace the calling of citizenship and know the value of truth, justice, and excellence in all their various forms. That's a heavy burden, but it can make your life worth living. So, be good, have fun, show the world what a Bard education means, and vote.
As we move to the last honorary degree, I want to say to Ellen, I am not honoring the institution, only verifying that I earned a degree. It just happened to be from that institution. And finally, I recognize David Schwab, again, from the class of 1952, and David Tibbetts, the professor of biology, who will present to George Rose for the honorary degree.
President Botstein, I have the honor of presenting George D. Rose, class of 1963, as a candidate for the honorary degree of Doctor of Humane Letters.
George Rose has had a remarkable career, highlighted by tackling problems that others shied away from, then applying novel ideas and methodologies to solving them. Time and again, he has demonstrated the power of original thought that is guided, but not overly constrained, by previous work in the field. This citation could easily have been written by a Bard faculty member in biology, chemistry, computer science, or physics, since he has admirers in each program. He graduated with a concentration in mathematics, but was in fact a student in many disciplines. In the early 1960s, students in the Division of Natural Sciences and Mathematics at Bard College were relatively few. but they were highly motivated and often exceptionally creative. The small group of faculty in the division responded by expanding their breadth of understanding in their own field, as well as in cognate disciplines. Resourceful students like George benefited the most from this model of confronting interesting ideas and applying any tools that might prove effective. In those days, a savvy, math-capable person like George could establish a career in computing with few formal credentials. So he went to Oregon State University, becoming the manager of operating systems while completing a master's degree in mathematics and computer science. After reading Molecular Biology of the Gene by James D. Watson, he decided to enter graduate school in biochemistry in his 30s. He finished his PhD at Oregon State and began a series of academic and research appointments that culminated at Johns Hopkins University, where he's held prestigious positions in the Department of Biophysics and Biophysical Chemistry since 1994. Most of the basic processes that underlie the functioning of cells and larger organisms involve proteins taking on specific shapes in specific circumstances. George has been an innovator in adopting new computational approaches to test hypotheses about how these macromolecules take the shapes that they do, which is at the heart of the protein folding problem. A compelling principle of his approach has been a self-stated predisposition to seek simple models for complex phenomena, an attitude grounded in a sophisticated understanding that science investigations are almost always about developing a model of some kind. His richly diverse skill set has equipped him to employ lessons learned in all areas of modern science. His numerous publications show a subtle thinker adapting ideas from chemistry, biology, and physics to the interactions in proteins, then applying advanced computational approaches to bring those theories to life. As a fitting climax to a career about how to pose and solve problems, George taught a course in 2018, Thinking About Thinking for Bard non-science majors. Describing the class, he said, "How have we learned to make sense of the physical world? The answer is far from obvious. A query and quest that drive his life as a scientist. The course represented a full circle for him as he passed along to a new generation the legacy of his own Bard educators who pushed him to ask tough questions and be creative in answering them."
Actoritate mihi commissa, ter gradum incientis doctoris admito, omniaque jura ad privilegia, ad un gradum petitentia tibi concedo, in et testimonium hoc diploma tibi solemne trado. Congratulations.
Thank you. As you just heard, I was a guest lecturer here for a semester in 2018. I know so many of you now and admire so many of you. And coming from this school and these people, this honor is deeply meaningful to me. I want to congratulate the class of 2020, and I'd like to speak to the class of 2020. Everybody is aware of John Lewis, who died a month ago. He was an icon. He was a truly national icon. And incidentally, he was the speaker, the commencement speaker at Bard 3 years ago. I'd like to tell you about another icon, somebody that you haven't heard of. His name was Harry Goheen. He was a professor of mathematics at Oregon State University in Corvallis. He was many things. In addition to his professional obligations in the Department of Math, he went every week to the to Oregon State Penitentiary in Salem to teach. This was decades before the Bard Prison Initiative. Harry was also the president and founder of the Corvallis chapter of the NAACP. Harry was white. But the specific thing I'd like to tell you about today is Harry's activities in another venue. So I arrived at Oregon State in 1967 to take a job in the computer center. My office was in Kidder Hall. The front of Kidder Hall opened onto a very large quad. 1967, Lyndon Johnson was president, and the war in Vietnam had been going on for 3 years since the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution in 1964. At that time, in protest around the country, people were encouraged to protest silently by going to a public place on Wednesday afternoons every week and standing silently in protest from 12 to 1. At Oregon State, every Wednesday, like clockwork at 12, Harry Goheen would go out to the quad in front of Kidder Hall and stand silently with his hat in his hand, his hat over his heart, and then saying nothing, standing like a statue. And then at 1 o'clock, he would leave and go away. That was the rainy season in Oregon. Often rain would be dripping off his balding head. He would stand there silently, and he would stand there alone because no one else was there. This went on for some time, but a strange thing started to happen. After a few weeks, maybe a little longer than a few weeks, a couple of other people came to the mall on Wednesdays at noon, came to the quad at Wednesdays at noon to join Harry. And then a few more after that, and then a few more after that. And after about a year, on Wednesday afternoons, there were hundreds of people standing in the quad silently for an hour. I want you to recognize that one person can truly make a difference. That was perhaps the beginning of the end of the war in Vietnam, although it took many years to wind down. So I leave you with just one word: vote.
I want to thank all of you for your patience in this ritual of Wagnerian length, but it, as I said, happens only once a year. The last speech is traditionally in these ceremonies left to me as president of the college, and that is the charge to the graduates of 2020. In all the years I've had the privilege and honor of serving Bard College as its president, I've never been prouder of a graduating class than I am of the class of 2020. You are leaving the hallowed halls of a place of teaching and scholarship dedicated to the ideals of learning, debate, inquiry, curiosity, and skepticism at an unprecedented moment in history. There has never been a time quite so dark and so terrifying. The horror and carnage of both World War II and the Vietnam War remain far away and distant from most Americans. In the era of the Great Depression, this country was still a manufacturing nation and a densely agricultural one. No matter how long a recovery might take, there was a shared familiarity with what the future might look like. And in 1932, we elected, in a landslide, a new government, intent on breaking with the past and on realizing the power of government to help those most in need and to renew the spirit of the nation. You are graduating, Bard, at a time when devastation is here at home, giving you and your family and friends every reason to be anxious and disconsolate. The reasons for fear are all too obvious. First, the pandemic is still with us. Suffering and fear are all around us. Those poorest and least able to defend themselves have borne a disproportionate burden of the national pain. The threat of the disease has been exacerbated by the incompetence and cruelty of our leaders in our national government and our collective failure to design and implement a viable, consistent national strategy. The absence of a rational and fair healthcare system for all has become all too evident, as has the irresponsible neglect of our scientific community and its expertise and ingenuity that could have been marshaled in time to contain the damage. Second, you face an economic crisis, perhaps greater than that of the Great Depression. The rates of unemployment are skyrocketing. Jobs are disappearing, as are workplaces, companies, and traditional patterns of economic life. The much vaunted third industrial revolution, driven by technology, has gutted the need to employ our fellow citizens in large numbers, particularly those without a proper education or skills. Third, amidst this perfect worldwide storm of economic collapse and dangers to our health, we are now confronted, and properly so, as a consequence of violence against people of color and Black Lives Matter, with the necessity of coming to terms, finally, with the central question of race and discrimination, that, as a consequence of slavery and unrelenting discrimination, has wounded this republic since its founding. We must, as a society, provide real and civic reparations to our fellow citizens of color in providing now genuine access to equality in housing, health, educational, and a viable economic safety net. Fourth, we must not ignore the poor and the intolerable inequality of wealth in this country and throughout the rest of the world. No ethical defense of the right to property can be mounted on behalf of a society that permits 1% of the population to own 38.5% of the wealth, and where single individuals can amass a net worth larger than the GDP of sovereign nations. As you gaze beyond the confines of Bard, even close to us here in Dutchess County, much less far beyond in the heartland of the nation, you can discover how profoundly we have permitted governments, Democratic and Republican alike, to neglect over decades most of our fellow citizens, white and black, and favor in the technological revolution, as the saying goes, Wall Street over Main Street. Fifth, we all face, without question, the enormity of climate change and the consequences of environmental neglect. The fires in California, the floods in Iowa, the melting of the ice in the north and the rising seas are just the most obvious facts that we all, rich and poor, of many different ethnicities and beliefs, must confront. Vast stretches of the globe will be inhospitable to human existence, and we must deal justly with the massive migration from south to north. What does this all add up for each and every one of you? The five circumstances in the world today just enumerated have eroded public confidence in democracy. They have fueled a sense of powerlessness and whetted a popular appetite for autocracy and tyranny. The danger is not only here in the United States. The 20% of the class of 2020 come from abroad understand this political trend all too well in China, Russia, Turkey, the Philippines, Hungary, and Poland, for example. So to you, the class of 2020, I say, do not despair, but do not hide behind blind hope. You, alongside of all of us, face an unprecedented opportunity to make history. Elaborate dialectics are not required to see how we can make, with your help, quickly, a far better and more just world. There are six reasons, members of the class of 2020, to face the future after Bard College with uncommon optimism, enthusiasm, and courage. First, never before has the need for government and good government been so clear. The nonsense put forth four decades ago that government was the problem and that we need less of it has now been exposed as malicious. We need better government for sure, but not less. Society cannot rely on the presumed superiority of private enterprise. Second, we have a chance to create good government. We can rescue the rule of law. We can put a stop to corruption. We can defeat the manipulation of public opinion by deceit and outright lies. We can restrain the abuse of force, as in Portland, and we can bring the compelling ideals of equality and justice enshrined in the founding documents of this nation to life. Each of you must vote and devote the weeks ahead to ensuring that the election in November is not stolen, not disfigured by the suppression of voting or the abuse of the postal system or stripped of legitimacy by false accusations of fraud. Third, you have now, by virtue of having graduated from college, joined a minority, an elite. Whether you are first-generation college graduates or not, you will be able to compete. You have the skills of inquiry, curiosity, criticism, and improvisation, hallmarks of a liberal education and liberal learning, honed from the first days of L&T to the submission of your senior projects. You have the education, the economy, and politics of this century demands. You therefore can lead in realizing justice and equity, empathy, and the recognition of the sanctity of every human being, strengthened as it should be by the love of the imagination and the arts, and join in restoring an embrace of immigrants and a tradition of dissent and kindness to strangers that is the highlight of a pluralistic democracy. Fifth, you understand the power of education. You must join the fight to wipe out student debt, change the way we finance higher education. We must renew Abraham Lincoln's most unsung gift to this nation, the Morrill Act that created our land-grant public universities, must refinance all our public universities. And like Bard itself, you must be vigilant in seeing to it that after the nightmare of our current government is over, we give our fellow citizens the public elementary and secondary education a true democracy deserves. Only with a system of education that is both equitable and excellent can the promise of freedom and the rights of democracy and open society be realized for all. And if anything has been learned from during this pandemic, and you've learned it, it is that there is no technological utopia or fix in education. True learning and intellectual and artistic progress have been made and will continue to be made in a community of scholars, scientists, students, and artists, in person and in groups, without masks, without isolation and social distance, without a balance between the individual and the social, and the ability to see the smiles of others, freedom and justice will not flourish. And sixth and last and not least, as you go forth, remember how rare, valuable, fragile, but resilient Bard, your alma mater, is. Protect and defend it. And so too other indispensable intermediate and non-governmental institutions, libraries, museums, theaters, concert halls, and civic groups. They too are crucial to the better world we now have the opportunity to create swiftly and decisively in defense of truth and justice. With respect, gratitude, and admiration, I congratulate each and every one of you in this unique graduating class of 2020. So now we turn to our main event. We start with the graduate degrees, and I want to introduce Jonathan Becker, the Executive Vice President, Vice President for Academic Affairs, Director of the Center for Civic Engagement, and the Vice Chancellor of the Open Society University Network, and who is standing in for Norton Batkin, our departing Dean of Graduate Studies, who's not able to join us today. Jonathan Becker.
Thank you very much, President Botstein. Before we begin the presentation of graduate degrees, please note that all of the candidates have completed the requirements for their degrees as prescribed by the State of New York and by the faculty and trustees of Bard College. And if I may add a little bit more, I want to say that I know most of the people here watching are here for people receiving BA degrees and some for AA degrees, which we heard about earlier. But it's really important to recognize that Bard has wonderful, world-class graduate programs. Some of those are in music, and I know David Byrne, who spoke earlier today, would be very proud of that. In other artistic areas, curatorial studies, decorative arts and fine arts, in environmental studies and sustainability. Our graduate programs also work with our international campuses. The MAT, which is a fantastic program, works with Rohingya, in Bangladesh. They offer degrees in Kyrgyzstan. And in Palestine, they offer the largest degree-granting master's program in the Palestinian territories. Graduates of that program, there's more than 500, teach more than 115,000 Palestinian students each year, which is really an amazing feat. Those of you watching from afar may notice that there are flags up on either side of the stage, and these represent many of Bard's partnerships internationally and domestically. I like to speak about something I call One Bard. And One Bard means that whether you are a student in Russia or Palestine, if you are in a microcollege in Brooklyn or in Holyoke, if you are an incarcerated student in New York, if you are a student in a Bard High School or early college in New Orleans, Baltimore, Washington, Cleveland, New York City, Newark, up in Hudson, that you are part of one institution, which, as Linda Johnson said previously, believes so fundamentally in the transformative power of liberal arts and sciences education. Graduate students, about whom you will hear today, are part of that one Bard, and we celebrate their success before we move on to our other students. So with that said, President Botstein, on behalf of Susan Weber, director of the Bard Graduate Center and the Iris Horowitz Professor in the History of the Decorative Arts, I have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in Decorative Arts, Design, History, Material Culture. The candidates for the Doctorate of Decorative Arts, Design, History, Material Culture include Amy Elizabeth Bagansky, Matthew Burroughs Peters Kegel, and Rebecca Ann Perry.
Auctoritata mi commissa, vos ad gradum philosophiae doctoris in artibus decorantibus Historia decoris cultura materiali admito omniaque iure ac privilegia ad cum gradum pendinentia vobis concedo et in testimonium hoc diploma vobis solemniter trado. Congratulations.
I now have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Philosophy in Decorative Arts, Design History, Material Culture. Michael Jonathan Ussies, Christina Laguna De Leon, Michelle Jackson Beckett, Rebecca Jumper Matheson, Sarah Louise Scaturo, Courtney Ann Stewart, Amanda Thompson. It is also my pleasure to present the following members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Arts in Decorative Arts, Design History, Material Culture. Laura J. Allen, Jordan Burkett, Christina Marie DeCola, Nicole D. Collins, Emily Hayflick, Elizabeth Kane, Shi Lin Lin, Jinyi Liu, Jacqueline Marie Mazzone, Will Niebergall, Yi Rong, Rachel Schwabi, Madeline Rose Warner, Danielle Faye Windling, Caleb Weintraub Weissman, Alice Carolyn Winkler, Coco Chiwan Zhao. President Botstein, I have the honor of introducing Hannah Barrett, the director of the Milton Avery Graduate School of the Arts, who will present the members of the class of 2019 for the degree of Master of Fine Arts.
Luis Arnias, Obi Sotiris Gonzalez Picos, Lauren Luis Burrow, Gwennon Eliza Davies, Omari Duglin, Carolina Fendino, Carolyn Elizabeth Ferrucci, Mark Gomez, Colleen Hargaden, Evie K. Horton, Christiana Huber, Rachel Simone James, Jamie Elise Krasner, Leona Nawiniokala E. Lanzalotti, Daniela Lader, Isabel Mallet, Carla Jean Mayer, Lee Nacham, Brandine Ndifi, Diane Guyen, Jackson Randall, Miko Rivereza, Alicia Nicole Salvadeo, Robert Joseph Sandler, Josephine Sharzad Shokrian, Estelle Srivyatakar, Jordan Straffer, Daniel Sullivan, Christopher Van Ginhoven Ray, Jessica Sarah Wilson, Alexander Bijan Zandi.
President Botstein, on behalf of Naylin Blake, class of 1982, and chair of the International Center of Photography, Bard Program in Advanced Photographic Studies, I have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Fine Arts. Jeremy Kurland Brenner, Emily Anderson Schiavelli, Ian Lloyd Edward Hunt, Beverly Logan, Tomohira Morisawa, Cheryl Mukherjee, Danny R. Peralta, Alexander Benjamin Remnick, Vera Marcella Saldivar de Lira, Ronald C. Young, Yiju Zha Zhang, Yiming Zheng. President Botstein, I have the honor of introducing Eben Goodstein, Director of the Bard Center for Environmental Policy, who will present the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Science in Environmental Policy.
Tricia Crystal Balasubramanian, Brenna Sophia Bushy, Samuel Carlson Calhoun, Lindsay Aaron Drew, Joseph Stephen O'Brien Applegate, Clifton Lawrence Staples, Corey Elizabeth Tiger, Myla Ann Whalen Kipp. It's also my pleasure to present the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Science in Climate Science and Policy. Rachel Gabrielle Dunn, Emma Rose Elbaum. And finally, I have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Education in Environmental Education, Craig Alexander Diaz and Syrah Madeline Reichel.
President Botstein, on behalf of Lauren Cornell, Director of the Graduate Program, Center for Curatorial Studies in Art and Contemporary Culture, I have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Arts in Curatorial Studies. Sukanya Bhaskar, Muhibula Esmat, Marissa Coespe, Julia Gardner, Bergen North Hendrickson, Sienna Estelle Leschley, Anna Teresa Lopes, Elizabeth Marie Lawrence, Maria Camilla Montalvo, Brooke Livingston Nicholas, Elizaveta Alexandrovna Schneiderman, Weichu Michelle Song, Rachel Vera Steinberg. President Botstein, on behalf of Derek Furr, Director of the Master of Arts and Teaching Program in Annandale and Hudson, I have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Arts in Teaching. Christopher R. Bennett, Matthew J. Esposito, Summer Grace Flamister, Nanda Jean Vashti Fogel, Claire Marie Gotch, Megan Angela Yeager, Emma Catherine Kuzmanov, Anastasia Tess Milova, Isabella Clay Martinez, Thomas N. Nelson, Jacob Alexander Pasa, Joshua Martin Perez, Garth Sutherland, Nikki Sway, Samuel Hugo Wilner, Jacqueline Helena Woods. President Botstein, on behalf of Stephanie Blythe, Artistic Director of the Graduate Vocal Arts Program, Bard College Conservatory of Music, I have the honor of introducing Frank Corliss, Director of the Bard College Conservatory of Music, who will present the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Music in Vocal Arts.
Maggie Jean McGuire, Brad Edward Testerman, and Margaret Tig.
President Botstein, I have the honor of introducing James Bagwell, Director of Music Performance Studies, Graduate Conducting Program, Bard College Conservatory of Music, who will present the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Music in Conducting.
Glenn Edward Alexander II and Prokhor Protasov.
President Botstein, I have the honor again of calling upon Eben Goodstein, who will present the members of the class of 2020 for the Master of Business Administration in Sustainability.
Eliza Livingston Edge, Emma Rose Elbaum, Stephanie K. Irwin, Diana Kirsten Farmer, Jesse Kai Gersten, Kristen Joyce Hangsor, Anthony Christopher Hoyt, Brett David Landau, Brian Matthew Lechte, Maureen Elizabeth McCarthy, Caitlin Gloria O'Donnell, Nicole Ramesh Pamani, Savannah Jane Parsons, Carolyn Lee Pincus, Roxanne Alexandra Sharif, John Robert Stallings III, Janet Kryenbreck Viotter, Daniel Jacob Wachowski, Sahana B. Zatushi.
President Botstein, on behalf of Jan Kriegel, Director of the Levy Economics Institute Graduate Program in Economic Theory and Policy, I have the honor of presenting the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Science in Economic Theory and Policy. Barkin Gianelli, Esteban Rivera, Maroki Sawo, Sean Turlin, Alexander Trent Williams. It is also my pleasure to present on Jan Kriegel's behalf the following members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Arts in Economic Theory and Policy. Edward Eugene V. Dunn, Madeline Margaret Johnson, Wynn Shepherd Miller, Max von Holzendorf. President Botstein, I have the honor of calling upon James Bagwell, Academic Director of the Orchestra Now and Professor of Music and Arts, who will present the members of the class of 2020 for the degree of Master of Music in Curatorial, Critical, and Performance Studies.
Kyle Anderson, Regina Simone Brady, Joshua DePoint, Carl Allen Gardner, Shannon Kathleen Hagen, Ji-Yoon James Kim, Emily Jean Melendez, Yuri Mitsuhashi, Frederico Luis Ramos Espejo, Adam Christopher Romy, Matthew Ryan Ross, Dennis Salyeyev, Luke David Stentz, Zhenyuan Yao.
Auctoritate mihi commissa, vos ad grados magistri philosophiae et artium, e artium elegantorum e scientia e artum docendi et musica et negotia administrandi ad copias tuendas admito, omniaque jura ac privilegia ad hos gradus pernitetiae vobis concedo et in testimonium hoc diploma vobis solemniter trado. Congratulations. We will now turn to the first granting of microcollege degrees through our microcollege in Brooklyn and also the microcollege with the Care Center in Holyoke, Massachusetts. And it is my pleasure to introduce Megan Callahan, the Dean of the Bard Prison Initiative, who will present the 2020 candidates who've completed the requirements for the associate's degree as prescribed by the State of New York, the faculty and trustees of Bard College.
Lukiki Venus Akola, Shakora L. Baldwin, Omawati Bahari, Paris Monique Brantley, Michael Brown Jr., Tessa Ann Colon, Elizabeth Crespo Colon, Tamika W. Daly, Richard Davidson, Jonathan Gall, Hakeem Haley, Roxanne Holmes, Victoria Marie Ladzinski, Pearl Bernice Manis, Loida Maria Martinez, Chelsea Marie Montanez, Angelique Marie Roy Santos, Purvis Thompson, Amber Janice Torres, Jacqueline Velez Vasquez, Priscilla Zambrano.
Auctoritate mihi commissa, vos ad grado soci in artibus admito, omniaque iure ac privilegia ad hos grados pertinentia vobis concedo et in testimonium hoc diploma vobis solemniter trado. Congratulations to you all. We now turn to the last and the largest degree granting ritual, and that is to the undergraduate degrees of the class of 2020. And graduating Bard is no easy feat. You have to design and execute a senior project. You'll see on the slides every student's senior project title and the advisor. And the range of ambition of these projects is very impressive. Also, the amount of time invested in them is impressive, both by its virtuosic shortness and its incredible duration. There's a wide extreme, and all of them reflect imagination and ambition, and we're extremely proud. And 100% of the class of 2020 finished senior projects, despite the pandemic, and despite the move to online education. I'm very pleased to present the Dean of the College, Deirdre Dalbert, Professor of English, who will present the bachelor degrees.
President Botstein, trustees, faculty, both here and watching at home, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to present the following members of the class of 2020 for the degrees of Bachelor of Arts and Bachelor of Music. These candidates have completed all the requirements for this degree as prescribed by the State of New York and by the faculty and trustees of Bard College. Samuel J. Abate. Doreen Giyama Adutwumu. Artin Ak. Oriel Ackerley. Charlotte Miriam Albert. Salim Alumaidi. Gemma Goodspeed Allen. Aurora Juliet Amidon. Emily Hope Anastasi. Miriam Anastasi. Susan Melissa Andreas. Brian Arak Perez. Julianne Emma Arnold. Gustav Henry Aronson. Dylan A. Asfer. Alina R. Augustin. Giselle Lucia Avia. Eduard Camille Avias Mercedes. Mizba Jonas Awan. Ioli Helena Baltus. Midori Constancia Barandarian. Theodora Luisa Barrett. Catherine Banks Baum. Bernadette Benjamin. Olivia Evelyn Berkey. Olivia Hart Berlin. Emma Sylvie Bernstein. Aliyah Beham. Tinatine Bejanica. David Nelson Black. Michael Brent Blackman. Sarah Batsheva Bonder. Wallace Rose Borum. Joquel Borthwick. Anna Sophia Andrea Botti. Lucas Theo Ulysse Bourgeon. Nellie Jean Bowen. Phoebe Schuyler Brand. Gabriel Francis Brownstein. Jeanette S. Brent. Christina Ray Brinzak. Haley Rose Britt. Maho Therese Brooks. Garrett Glenn Brown. Brandon Marlis Brum. Colin Michael Brundage. Maya Thule Bruno Bossang. Benjamin J. Bryant. Lola Elaine Buncher. Alexander Wesley Bunnell. Will Cameron Berghart. Coleman Tomasino Burke. Evan Burke. Joseph Burke. Brenna Sophia Bushy. Madeline Pearl Busby. Juan Carlos Cabrera. Matthew Cato. Sonny Salvatore Philip David Capaccio. Sebastian Rafael Cardenas. Bridget Catherine Carey. Philip Martin Carroll. Ezekiel Napoleon Chabon. Thalia Celeste Shai Zhang. Angelo Ilya Raphael Shama. Emma Elizabeth Champeau. Julia Chara. Derek Chavez. Liliana Chavez. Yan Chen. Winston Courier Cheney. Shirley Chang. Genevieve Dominic Chiola. Yutian Zhou. Victoria Choi. Madison Marie Clark Bruno. Axel Tiger Clavier. Tanner Daniel Cohen. Jonathan Itai Colazzo. Jane Morgan Colon Bonet. David Thomas Camisanis. Megan Grace Connor. Cheyenne Crow Conti. Allegra Allen Cooper. Kathleen Cooper. Josephine N. Cotton. Ewan James Creed. Luca Adrian Cristo. Jacob Tilden Cummings. Lovani Madeli Kendon. Cheyenne Rose Cutter. Yuanshan Dai. Dylan James Dane. Emma Lee Daly. Anna Maddalena Sacocchio Dalvia. Katrina Nancy Davia. Glenn Ariel Desity. Justin C. Diaz. Alexandra M. Diaz Albertini. Ethan P. Dickerman. Sydney Doblin. Sophia Claire Doktoroff. Eric Doherty. Gracie Nora Downs. Macy Clarice Downs. Grace E. Drennan. Cullen Cade Drissel. Julia Elizabeth Eifert. Adele Elkafas. Iris Byrne Ingle. Jemra Zainab Aram. And I just want to pause here before we move to the next name. President Botstein has just a word to say about this graduate.
Not to delay the proceedings, but every year we have a graduate who earns the same degree as our other undergraduates who comes from the Bard Prison Initiative. The next candidate is a graduate of BPI, and we are honored to have him among us.
And that graduate actually is one slide back. Curtis Lee Evans. Curtis Lee Evans. Dexter Kennedy Fadness. Adam Ahmed Falah. Anna Laura Grace Falvey. Heli Fong. Alexander Fedchin. Alexandra N. Ferguson. Adam Ferrucci. Adele Elizabeth Finch. Nicholas Joseph Fiorellini. Beau Elliott Fisher. Brittany Michelle Fleming. Rachel Nicole Flynn. Elias M. Fokine. Nicholas Roman Fopiano. Charlotte Catherine Foreman. Alexis Renee Foster. Tuscany Eden Fusar. Amber Rose Fowley. Jasper Francis. Estrella Marie McKinney Frankenfeld. Abigail Catherine Freer. Zuri Catherine Frew. Louisa Jane Fulkerson. Aiden Furs. Lilia Galechian. Adam Burley Game. Gabriela Elise Garcia. Lourdes Vanessa Garcia. Tristan Jules Geary. Sarah Rose George. Margaret Grace Gerber. Emily Nicole Giangiulio. Jaimon Mark Gibson. Julia Ann Gibson. Noah Zachary Gichan. Sarah Gichan. Malcolm O'Gilbert. Jamie Gray Chandler Gillette. Veronica Elizabeth Gillis. Alexandra Hobart Gilman. Dahlia Gregory Glatzman. Samuel Hunter Gohl. Gabriella Sarah Goldberg. Sarah Pavlovna Goldberg. Katrina Francisco Gonzalez. Sneha Gopinath. Colette Rose Goupil. Jaden Adia Gray Huff. Avery Nicole Greenberg. Michael Buffett Greenberg. Tessa Craig Greenhalter. Clara Violet Griffin. Darcy Isabel Sear Groves. Yifan Gu. Hannah Jane Gundel. Vedika Gupta. Edgar Elias Gutzman. Megan Elizabeth Halm. Qingxuan Han. Yuwei Han. Alexander Montalvo Hardy. Caitlin Elizabeth Harris. Richard Owen Hartman. Yanhan Ha. Quentin Lyle Healy. Lucas Graham Hemmer. Anthony Elijah Francis Henry. Hannah Victoria Herrick. Fiona Marie Hessian. Kuki Higashino. Maisie Leora Hillman. Holden Pater Hulinamaz. Idao Ho. Juno Atamitsia Tankotko Hobbs. Rachel Abigail Hodes. Nicole Holland. Margaret Holloway. Jakir Mohammed Hussein. Emma Nicole Houghton. Maya Josephine Howard. Shur Huang. Yining Huang. Samuel Francisco Huggins. William Thomas Hunt. Jens Nicholas Jebsen. Luke Britton Jennings. Ava L. Johnson. Ryan Thomas Jones. I want to recognize Madeline Margaret Johnson. Marco Jukic. Amber Nicole Junker. Marine Kabir. Logan P. Kalebling. Ezra Charlie Khan. Caitlin Elizabeth Carmen. Christian Jermaine Katza. Angela Irene Katinas. John Templeton Gay K. William Roy Kettner. Lily Coyote Keys. Samuel Nelson Kiley. Arthur Kilongo. Sian Gabre Kiros. Mary Elizabeth Klein. Olivia Constam. Shay Afshin Kotari. Tristan Theodore Kozel. George Eli Koonin. Julia Elizabeth Kuntz. Marina Elizabeth LaPrade. Brian Lee. Hugh Lee. Wan Jun Lee. Raphael Leland Cox. Jacob Edelstein Lester. Mitchell J. Levinson. Sinran Lee. Zigio Lucy Lee. Yusen Liu. Jen Liu. Emma K. Laughlin. Riley Mahoney Loind. Bingyu Lu. Paula Elena Luxinger. Sylvie Hannah Lundgren. Alexander David Lynch. Coco Ma. Yusin Ma. Skylar Dickinson Mason. Francis Mairead Macarillo. Joshua David Maldonado. Harrison Malinowski. Lilia Rose Manis. Alexis Kimberly Maresca. Gita Marco. Danielle Alexandra Martin. Ariana Selena Martinez Perry. Adira Ann Martin Rubin. Samuel Alexander Martucci. Willem J. Marks. Olivia Grace Mason. Timothy William Matsakis. Ava Russell Maisie. Eli Sticks McClatchy. Maya Sophia McClatchy. Jacob Martin McConaughey. Anna E. McAvoy. John Luis McKeon. Abigail Ruth McCrell. Andres Isidro Meraz. Megan Lee Mercier. Wynn Shepherd Miller. Hannah Blythe Mills. Suyuan Min. Wasir Kadar Muhammad. Rachel Ani Mordecai. Julia Mueller. Skylar Michael Harp Muldar. Joshua Walter Murphy. Khawaja Muhammad Musamil. Sandai Nana Buluku. Peyton Richard Nash. Leah Sarah Nazar. Andrea Nazario Quinones. Lauren Elizabeth Nelson. Jeremiah Paul Neri. Tejaswi Nupane. Tui Cheng Wen. Matt Rayner Nikoloff. Paul Alistair Nicholson. Noah H. Nickerson. Isabella Rose Nitolo. Daisy Olivia No. Zaid Youssef Normand. Liam Gabriel Oberholzer. Maeve Isabel O'Brien. Mara O'Connell. Phoebe Ray O'Connell. Michael Richard O'Donnell. Peter Harry O'Donnell. Una Gray Oglesby. Emanuela Chinazza Okoli. Sabrina Rose Oliver. Andrea Michelle Ote. Jack Ryan Paliante. Brianna Maria Palma. Yushi Pan. Chihuang Park. Kristen Almeida Parabek. Emma Lee Patsy. Vasya Pemberton. Michelle Pendergast. April Fionn Perrin Wogenberg. Lydia Hope Perry. Zoe Emily Peterschild Ford. Christina Petishkova. Bridget Shannon Pfeiffer. Kayla Molly Piscatelli. Michael Francis Pizzuto. Isabel Poletta. Maeve Egan Potter. Alex Prestrud. Colin Michael Pritchard. Hector Charles Prudhomme. Jessica Margaret Pullen Schmidt. Abigail Lee Rousseau. Miranda Virginia Real. Lucille Holland Reback. Lucy Madeline Reese. Corey Alexander Rich. Ethan James Richman. Esteban Rivera. Matthew Jordan Robinson Roble. Mary Carol Ann Rockwood. Alicia Maria Rodriguez Rivera. Glennis Eileen Romero Medina. Melissa Ann Rosenthal. Elliot Harris Roski. Kate Louise Rooley. Ryan Russica. Nadia Russell. Christian S. Sabarwal. Miranda Cahill Sanborn. Isabella Emma Menuez Santana. Danielle L. Santos. Max Jacob Sato. Violet Una Savage. Maeve McKenna Shallert. Mia Rachel Schiffer. Christina Gabriella Secor. Liam Edward Schaefer. Rachel Renee Hassett Shamsi. Nathaniel Constantine Shelley. Sienna Maria Elena Shearer. Caleb Madison Alexander Short. Olivia Kathleen Shubin. Rebecca Rose Sicari. Patricia Ann Margaret T. Seacut. Sarah Jean Sieber. Isabel Ivy Simic. Scarlett Ann Sine. Ty Harris Singer. Pranav Hari Singhania. Ariadne Sinis Borosicus. Curtis H. Sirkoch. Jewel Emina Smith. Tahokazil Aretha Soko. Wenfei Song. Bruno Souza Dinucci. Jackson G. Sparger. Dominique Alicia Spencer. Augusta Valeria Tiziana Spiro Jaeger. Livia Elizabeth Sponberg Paraday. William Charles Squire. Eleanor Theodora Quitney Stapleton. Leah Pere Stern. Ailey Judith McGregor Strauss. Austin A. Sumlin. Shunhui Swen. Abigail Yvonne Schwartzbacher. Joya Alia Sied. Maricela Talamantes. Horace Faiz Tower. Adriana M. Tampasis. Sana Tariq. Leah Jalen Taus. Isaac H. Tay. Elena Riley Taylor. Maya Annika Teich. Anastasia Elizabeth Teller. Anaisa Tri Tenuta. Michael Raquel Theodore. Elizabeth M. Thomas. Abigail Julia Townend. Olivia Leslie Traiano. Timothy Lindhurst Trumpet. Deki Tsering. Sean Turlin. Sophie Tarak. Brooke Taylor Tiborowski. Ian Joseph Ullman. Matthias Van Order Gonzalez. Nicole Grace Vashimini. Gabriella Vasquez Nassar. Michael Joseph Ventoso. Natalie Vergese. Rejo Verwai. David Lewis Vogel. Emily Michelle Walshen. Stephanie Najeri Wambugu. Xinyue Wong. Eben Wong. Jiawei Wang. Cullen Warner. Rose Noelle Wax. Victoria Iris Wayland. Theodore Beresford Webb. John Lewis Went. Olive Dunham Werby. Annika Marie Wett. Alyssa May White. Cassandra Lee Whitehead. Hetty Wilder Carlstrom. Alexandra Liliana Wilcox. Catherine Frances Lee Williams. Lindsay Grace Williams. Tyler Radcliffe Williams. Violet Alta Williams. Charles Heath Wood. Julia Nikati Wright. Xinfang Wu. Victoria Emily Wu. Ding Wen Ji. Cheng Shi. Jinyi Shui. Guang Yang. Marlena Elizabeth Yost. Justine Zaki. Claire Ava Zerb. Yushuan Chao. Zhuichi Zhou. Yumeng Zhu. Benedicta Hope Zicko Geithner. Elizabeth Julianne Zimmerman. And finally, Emmanuel C. Zion.
Thank you. Actoritate mihi commissa, vos ad grados baccalaureo in artibus, et musicae admito omniaque iure ac privilegia, ad hos grados pertitentia vobis concedo, et in testimonium hoc diploma vobis solemne trado. Congratulations to every member of the class of 2020.
Let us pray. We give thanks for this day as we acknowledge and honor the graduates of the class of 2020. Continue to grant them courage and fortitude in the days ahead, and fill them with your wisdom as they meet the new challenges in the world at large. Strengthen them in all things. Let them be instruments of change as they face new communities where they may apply all that they have learned and experienced here at Bard. Give them grace to make the world a place of justice, peace, and compassion. Guide them into all truth. Let them not forsake their love of learning and creativity. And in these times, may our graduates be beacons of hope, shining light where there is darkness, joy where there is despair, faith where there is doubt, mercy where there is discord, love where there is hate. And now go forth with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.